We're starting this season of Lent that I confess sometimes for me is a little bit hard to be with because it reminds you a lot about the sacrifice of Christ. And I am thankful for that, but I'm also hard. It's hard for me to remember it. But when people ask you, why do we celebrate Lent or what's the purpose of Lent? I want you to think in these ways. Number one, Lent is a time of repentance, fasting, and preparation for the coming of Easter. It is a time of self-examination and reflection. So that's kind of what is helpful too. It's a time when we need to say, you know, let me just have a moment to remember that there are places where I still need to grow and deal with. Do you have those places? But you say, you know, this is an area that I have put aside. I said that I don't have time. I need to deal with other problems. But Lent is a good time to bring that back in and say, you know, God, how do you want me to deal with this? Then the other thing that is key during Lent is that it's a good time to remember this number, 40. 40 is key on the Bible. Anytime that you see something with that number, it's going to be a season of testing, trial, and probation. However, at the end, that group of people or that person comes in a different place. It's like, for example, remember the times in the exile were 40 years. They came as slaves. They left as children of God. 40 times in the desert with Jesus. So you see, every time you see that number, it reminds you that trial. So that's a hope thing. At the end, there is hope on that. Now, there are 40 days right now on Lent. However, if you count them, you're going to be off because Sundays are not counted as these 40 days. Sundays are days that are like days of celebration too. So remember those things. And one of the things I want you to see is that I strongly believe God is calling Northern Hills United Methodist Church to be a church that is consecrated for God's will. And we learned during the last season about consecration is to be fulfilled. And we learned that through the Old Testament. But here too, we know how to be consecrated is part of being also a person that God created us to be. And there is no better place in the scripture where we can see that than in the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus is telling us who we are and how we are. And what kind of person we can be. Talking about that, I want to introduce to you a very awesome person. Do you know who she is? Yes, this is Katherine Johnson. She was one of those key people working at NASA. If you watch the movie of Hidden Figures, she was that person. And while she was not the only African-American, neither the first one, she was one of the strongest African-American women serving at NASA in a season where it was very hard to be African-American and women serving in that place. And she was able to do great things. But the reason I believe, too, why was she able to get where she was is because of the people that were surrounding her, too. Look what they told her.
Ms. Coleman, why don't you solve the equation on the board.
We took up a collection amongst the teachers and such. It's not a lot, but it's enough to help get you settled in.
That's more than kind, Miss Sullivan.
If the product of two terms is zero, then common sense says at least one of the two terms has to be zero to start with. So if you move all the terms over to one side, you can put the quadratics into a form that can be factored, allowing that side of the equation to equal zero. Once you've done that, it's pretty straightforward from there.
In all my years of teaching, I have never seen a mind like the one your daughter has. You have to go.
All right, guys, my math people, did that make sense? Because she says common sense. The only one that I believe, okay, Raymond, I know there, you know, okay. Paul Schneisi is the other one that I makes me think about. He can understand that. One time, you guys too, you're into math. Okay, so good. It's good. Okay, John, Jim, everyone gets it. Great. But because it says common sense, I'm like, that's not my common sense, guys. It just doesn't apply to me on that one. But what I like is what the teacher says. It says, in all my years of teaching, I have never seen a man like the one your daughter has. You have to go. What happened in this case is that people that were surrounding her, they saw this girl with potential. They saw the potential. So I want you to think in this way. God sees your potential. God sees your potential. There are so many times that we get fixed into our mistakes and our weaknesses. And I assure you, we all know where they are and we are aware of that. Nobody here is perfect. Many times I have asked you, raise your hand if you are one of those work in process, and we all raise our hand. We get that, right? But the purpose is we are a work in progress. There is potential. God sees us with potential. He sees who we can become. And that's precisely what this sermon is about and what God is speaking and Jesus is speaking in the Sermon on the Mount. God sees your potential. How does he do that? He does that because this potential comes from blessing. It comes from his blessing. Now, the situation is this. We use the word blessing kind of lightly in our culture. So that's why it kind of loses the power of the meaning in it. Besides that, as you remember, several years ago, I preached with you about what is the meaning of blessed, Makarios. We talk about that. So there are different kinds of blessings. And for example, one is a good desire. When you, somebody right now with the allergies, you just sniff, you say what? God bless you, right? Bless you. Like, Nan, bless you, Nan, right now. Okay. Wishful thinking is when you desire something for another person. May you be happy. It's just a desire. But then here in the scripture, what we're talking about is a very different kind of blessing. This is about Makarios. You remember that word? I told you this before. I hope you remember every single part of that sermon that was the foundation in Matthew. We did the quilts. I remember that. We did different quilts with that. So Makarios is the Beatitudes. And it is to bless someone is to extend or make greater that which one has given it to another. So it's a way of saying, you know, my life is in a different place due to that blessing. Let me explain it in this way too. We have here Jesus saying this in Matthew in what chapter? 5. So we're talking, this is the very beginning of the Gospel of Matthew. So if he's doing it at Matthew 5, I want you to think about how does the disciples look at that moment? They were at the beginning of the ministry of Jesus. They were just starting to learn to be a disciple. They were just learning who this Jesus was. And even at the very end, do we see that they were like these powerful men? I mean, we see their mistakes. They were stubborn. They were fighting with each other. They denied Jesus. They ran. They were scared. They were in fear. We saw all of this part of the behavior of the disciples. So when Jesus is sitting in the Sermon on the Mount with them and other people, he's not just talking about, you know, you already got here. He's looking. He sees who he has, you know, and he looks at them and he says, you know, you're not there, but there is potential. Isn't that a great word of hope? That somebody looks at you as they look to this girl and say, you know, you have potential. How many of us, those words change your future? Because somebody, one time, one teacher, one person came and told you, you have potential. At the same time, how many times one word of one person put you down from that potential and told you, you can do this. You're so bad about it. You cannot do this. And then you just took that word and allowed that word to dictate your future. But here we have Jesus saying to these disciples, you have potential. And the potential is not coming from good desires or good intention. Is coming by the power of God among them. Now, the Beatitudes, think about them in this way. They are a vote of confidence for people to live according to the kingdom of God. It's a step of faith. They are not there yet, but we're hoping that they will get there. So when you hear them, it's not something that people are already doing. He's saying it as if they are doing it because he sees that potential and he sees that in us. Now, when you see the Beatitudes too, we're going to realize very quickly that the priorities in life, according to the Beatitudes, are very different from the priorities that our culture has. This is why we say that the Beatitudes are an upside down way of thinking in our lives. Another thing that is important with them is we list them as a checklist and we go check, check, check. You know, those are the Beatitudes. That's not how are presented in reality. I see it more like this. It is that you are blessed. You are in that place that Jesus put you, and because you are there, you're see, the way you see yourself is different, but the way you interact with the world is different too, because it's making a it's a consequence of how you have seen yourself equipped as a child of God. Then you interact to the world very different because of that. So I like a lot the way they do this. Now, from the Beatitudes, we're going to talk about three of them today, not all of them. The first one that we're going to see is number one. Let's see it together. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. This is a beautiful place. It is a place where you say, you know, I am empty. I am broken. But it is in here where Jesus says, come as you are. He's giving you a welcome. Come as you are. Many of us were feeling like that, poor in spirit. Have you been in those moments in life when you say, you know, I am feeling right now so broken and there is no meaning in my life that I'm barely making it for the next day? When you feel you just receive a diagnosis, you just receive a news that was difficult, you just learned that you lost your job, you have invested in a relationship and it didn't work, there are places at work that are not making sense, it just gets heavy. We have been there, but we feel just heavy. I have said this to you before, and like when you say, you know, the only thing I need is a dog to come and pee on me, and that's it, you know? Don't tell the bishop I said that, Esther, you know? So it's just, that's all what you need. You're like, is it possible? Do you have that in English? In Spanish, in Mexico, like, no más me falta que me haga pipí un perro, and that's it. So there are times when you feel like that. I'm even looking for the dog. Let's do the pee, and that I can go from there up, you know? So, but we feel like we are there. But the blessing that we have is that you're feeling empty. You're feeling that your life is meaningless. But what we need to remember is precisely the celebration of Lent. And what we remember in this time is what Philippians 2:7 says, but emptied himself, Jesus, taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of men. What it means is that emptiness that you have, that place that broke your life, that situation that is making your life meaningless, God, Jesus, is bringing that in himself and putting that in the cross. And by that, you and I have the opportunity to say, I don't need to carry that anymore. So we go to Jesus as we are. We don't need to pretend. We don't need to play the card that we need to cover ourselves. We do not go with Jesus when we have everything figured out. We go to Jesus when nothing is making sense. So through him, we can see our lives in a different way, because we have that promise of his specific action of redemption. And by that, he's clearly telling you and me, your life has a value to the point that I die for you. Isn't beautiful that we know, Jesus, I'm bringing this to the table. And Jesus is saying, fine, give it to me. I'll take care of it. I'll take care of it. I die on the cross for that. And I take care of it. The second blessing is, blessed are those who what? Mourn, for they shall be comforted. Now, this is a specific kind of mourn. This is not like my team lost. No, San Francisco, I'm sorry. You know, it's not about that. It's not about that. This is about when you realize, oh my goodness, my life is broken. And I have done mistakes that are really hurting myself and others. I am really sad about that. When it clicks to you that you have put your life in a place that wasn't healthy. You know what I'm talking about? When you say, I could have chosen different and I didn't do it and it's hurting me. So when you come to that conclusion of saying, I put my life in that place, what we have as Christians is that's not the end of us. There is more about us. And that comes from the promise of Jesus in 2 Corinthians 7:10. It says, for godly grief, I love that term. I never heard it before. Godly grief. It's a grief that comes because you know that your life, the decision you took, hurt you. hurt the people that you love around and hurt your relationship with Christ. So that godly grief produces a repentance. You realize, you say, I don't want to do this anymore. I realize that every time that I put myself there, I hurt somebody. And I don't want to do that anymore. That isolates me from others. It isolates you from other, from people you love and from God. What happened with Adam and Eve? As soon as they committed a sin, what happened? They isolate. So what we see here is Jesus is telling us, okay, when you feel that, it's good. When you realize I did something that hurt myself, it's a good feeling because then you realize you need repentance. I'm sorry. I'm sorry that I did this mistake. But it doesn't end there. It says this repentance that leads us to salvation. Salvation without regret is that gift that God provides to you and to me of salvation, of saying, God, I need to depend on you. If I want to be able to be successful in this, I can have and I need that salvation. And guys, you can try whatever you want, but when we have that wall of pride and we say, you know, I don't need that. I feel that, you know, I feel ashamed of what I did with Jesus and I don't want to come to Jesus. It sounds nice, but it's pride. The reality is we need to say, Jesus, I did a big mistake. I am sorry and I need your help. And you're promising me that the cross is bigger than my mistakes. And the cross is enough for me to be able to see my life in a different eye and to find that courage to be able to keep going. That is the potential that Jesus is. And things do not end there. When your life has been transformed, think about this. When you understand the value of your life in Christ, when you see the potential you have, when you realize I'm living free of sin, what will you do? When you say all those things that were difficult and harmful from my past do not dictate my future, how you feel about it? It's a feeling of freedom, but it also makes an impact with those who surround you. Because the fourth one there, it says, blessed are the what? Peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Peacemakers, and actually the one at the top, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Those two are a response, an answer of a relationship with Christ. So when God sees you with potential, it's not just an impact for you, but the impact of those who surround you. One of the things that John Wesley says that I love is this one. Do all the good you can, by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as you ever can. Why can we say that as Methodists? We can say that when we live in that Makarios, in that blessing. And by that blessing, we live in the potential that God has for all of us. There is one singer that I absolutely love that many times I have told you. His name is Crowder. I confess that he also reminds me Animal from the Muppets. And if you go to my office, you will see that I have one Animal there because I am in love. That was my first boyfriend, Animal in Muppets. But this guy who I love, his singing, and every time that I can, I will go and sing and jump and dance. So if you want to come with me, that's great, but just know that I'm going to be jumping and dancing. Nan, I'll go with you. Maybe Diana, we can make it, right? So, but he has a song that I love that we're going to hear also through communion that says, come as you are. And it says, there is hope for the hopeless and all those who have strayed. Come sit at the table, come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can cure. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can cure. Guys, today we have the table for us. We have the table that the Lord Jesus Christ has prepared for you and for me. And who is invited to that table? All of us in the way we are. It is in that table when we come and we say to the Lord Jesus Christ, God, you see me with potential, but I'm carrying all of this in myself that doesn't allow me to see myself as you do. But you come to Jesus and you give it to him in this table and you say, here it is, and allow the love of Christ take that from you and give you the potential of who you are, a child of God. So when you come to the table, come as you are, broken, overwhelmed, sad, celebrating because he has blessed you. In moments of questions, maybe you feel that your life right now needs to have a meaning again. As you are, come to the table and know that God is going to receive you there and say, you are welcome in here and you have potential. Leave that potential in Christ. Amen. Because